ladies can afford to go out and have their children looked after, or even to take their children to this restaurant to actually give them a meal.
Mm.
And if you will, and perhaps I'm a different era, my children are now 16 and 18, so perhaps it didn't go on then, but I don't understand how they could afford to take them, never mind have the facilities to deal with them. I mean, have you not come across this before?
What, you mean single-parent families with very little money to spare?
That's
in that respect,
right.
You mean, Tracy? Yes, absolutely.
There is no way that I could have taken my two girls out to eat or out to anywhere that would hopefully supply facilities.
Yeah. I think
this is a new era.
Yes, I think it was with Sue that we were talking earlier, wasn't it, about, she was a single parent, part of a single parent family as well. And she was saying that she works part time and that money is very, very tight. So, Teresa, I can completely understand your problem there. But thank you for calling in. Unfortunately, we have time for no more calls, but we will be back later on this evening, 10 o'clock. Our mystery guest, and a particularly interesting mystery guest tonight, between 10 and 11, our mystery guest will join us, and it'll be up to you to try and guess his or her identity. And then crime prevention for the elderly between 11 and 12 with Mervyn Kohler from Help the Aged and Hackney Crime Prevention Officer Peter Habershaw. I'm sure that you'll find it most interesting, and do take part if you'd like to in the bulk of the programme and in open line as well. I'll be back. Thank you for listening tonight, and I'll be with you again 10 o'clock tonight on LBC.
There'll be another commercial along in about 30 seconds. But first, some compact disc entertainment brought to you in a commercial by Philips. The kind of compact disc you'll get for a mere £4.99 when you buy any Philips compact disc player or system.
Your words turn into everything that I might say. Every thought, every smile finds its way back to you. Every step that I take, anything that I do. Oh, you know.
For details, see your participating Philips dealer. Philips, take a closer look.
261 Medium Wave, LBC Radio.
The 1 o'clock news. This is Clive Bull. The investigation into Austrian President Kurt Waldheim is said to have spurred the brother of a former British Prime Minister into considering an appeal against a prison term he received during the war. Playwright William Douglas Hume, the brother of one-time Conservative Premier Lord Hume, was sentenced to a year's hard labour for refusing to take part in an assault on a German-occupied village in France. Stephen Ward reports.
The 75-year-old playwright was a captain in the Royal Armoured Corps in 1944 when the attack on the village was ordered. The Sunday Times says Mr. Hume was worried that French civilians weren't allowed to leave before the battle and that 2,000 died during a bombardment of the village. The Times says Mr. Hume contacted his lawyer about a possible appeal following the check by historians into Austrian President Kurt Waldheim's war record. The historian said there were instances of officers going unpunished after disobeying unreasonable orders. And it would appear Mr. Hume might argue that it was unreasonable for him to take part in the attack on the French village.
Government plans to increase electricity prices are being challenged by the bosses' organisation, the CBI. The government wants to put up to 15% on bills over the next 2 years to fund future investment, but the CBI says it could cripple Britain's struggling businesses. Linda Duffin reports.
Energy Secretary Cecil Parkinson says the rises are needed to bolster the electricity supply industry, this at a time when the government's keen to privatise it. But the CBI says the sort of price increases he's forecasting will add about £1 billion to companies' costs when British business needs to invest heavily to fight off foreign competition. They've commissioned an independent report which challenges the government's sums. They say increases are unnecessary when the electricity industry's already made nearly £2 billion profit in the past year.
Newspaper tycoon Robert Maxwell appears to have chalked up a new media milestone. Today's Sunday Mirror, a paper which the very same Mr. Maxwell owns, begins serialising a book about his life, from his poverty-stricken childhood in Czechoslovakia to his present-day role as a publishing mogul. And what's more, the Sunday Mirror has a large exclusive tag stamped above the story. Independent Radio News. And the weather in town, cloudy and dry, minimum 7 Celsius 45 Fahrenheit, and out of town 5 degrees 41. The day ahead will be cloudy and dry as well, with some sunny spells. Mild for the time of the year, top temperature 12 Celsius 54 Fahrenheit.
Through the night on LBC Radio.
And tonight we're off into the kitchen for some live late night cooking. We're calling Schlomo Finchley right now for some advice. A cookery lesson for me and possibly for you as well if you've got the ingredients at home. Also room for the headlines quiz from the Sunday papers, a mystery celebrity, vintage comedy from Hancock's War Memories, and later on calls on the topic of your choice. Features and phone calls through the night on 24-hour LBC Radio.
Good news. Top skier and radio presenter Steve Jones will be back from his week on the piste on Monday to resume his seat on the lunchtime show. His special guest of the day is actor Simon Ward. There'll be a special report on Exploring Parenthood, an organisation set up to help people cope with the job they haven't been trained for, bringing up children. There's the Tales from the Courts of Law and the Lucky Seven quiz. Steve Jones, midday till 2 on Monday on LBC Radio.
Car Buyer magazine, every Thursday. It gives you a choice of more new and used cars than all of your local papers put together. And for less, just 30 pence. Car Buyer for car buyers. At your newsagents now.
Coming up in Sunday's AM with me, Henry Kelly and Diane Stradlin, we hear claims that the London School of Economics, once a hotbed of political radicalism, is now a home for you.
If you can hear me.
Yeah, I can. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Should hand over
rights. Standby.
Are slimming down, and why?
And what the best-dressed male will be wearing this summer. Presumably not that, Henry.
Join us between 7 and 10 on Sunday.
Yes, he is. Less than 10. Music ends. Back to you.
Just made it into the LBC Radio kitchen, and tonight it's a cooking extravaganza with Schlomo Finchley, who'll be on the phone shortly. And if you were listening to last night's programme, you'll know that we're going to attempt a little cookery lesson for me, and perhaps for you as well if you've got the ingredients. We'll be running through those shortly. We're also running the headlines quiz as per usual, and here are the three headlines. They're all taken from the Sunday papers. Record Breck is headline number one. Record Breck. Doctor set to win TV battle is number two. Doctor set to win TV battle. And the making of a legend. The making of a legend. Three stories, they're all in the Sunday papers, but what we want to know is the story behind the headline. And you'll face a prize question on the same subject if you get the right story. 01 353 8111. Dial now and we'll be taking calls on the headlines quiz as we attempt this recipe as well. Now, Schlomo, good morning. Are you there?
I'm here, Clive.
Now, I've had a very busy day getting around the supermarket and sorting out all the ingredients.
The shops have been terrible today, I tell you, Clive. We've sold so many Turkish schnitzels today.
Have you really?
It's been our best seller, so I'm sure it's something to do with your show. You must have a lot of listeners.
It's probably the publicity, yes. Now, I think what we ought to do, first of all, is just go through the ingredients again, check I've got everything.
Right, okay. Well,
okay.
First of all, did you get turkey or did you get the veal or the chicken?
I got turkey.
Excellent.
Yes.
Good. Right, so you got the turkey scallop. You need three eggs.
Three eggs, yes. Yes, they're sort of medium-sized ones. Is that okay?
That's about size four. Right. Size three or four times. You need four medium potatoes.
Four medium potatoes. I was not sure what you call a medium potato, but these are about 2.5 inches long. Is that about right?
Sounds about right.
Okay, I've peeled those already.
Lovely.
Just to save time.
Lovely. You could have a job at the restaurant. We need some half luck to make it.
Yes.
Have you got a large onion, or medium onion rather, peeled?
A medium onion, yes, I've peeled that, okay.
And you got your mozza meal from Alkis?
No, I got it from Jappy's in the end, but yes, I got the mozza meal.
I know him well.
Yes,
good,
that's right.
Of the family.
Jappy's, yes. It's medium, is that right?
That's the one.
Not for Passover use, it says.
That's right. That's fine. Not Passover now.
No.
We got some milk. If you want to keep it, I noticed after I called, one of your listeners pointed out that it wasn't kosher because we were mixing the milk with the meat. So if you want to keep this kosher, you don't have to use the milk.
You don't have to use the milk?
But I'll point that out a bit later on when we're actually cooking it.
I have brought some in. I've brought some UHT semi-skimmed. Will that do?
If you don't use it, you can make a cup of hot chocolate for afterwards.
Yes, I might need it, I tell you.
And you got your corn oil.
Got the corn oil, yes. Sunflower oil, in fact. Is that all right?
That's fine, yes.
Yeah.
Salt and pepper.
Salt and pepper, yes.
Cup of flour.
Cup of flour. Well, it's still in the packet at the moment.
You got your fresh thyme?
Fresh thyme? No, I couldn't get any fresh. I'm sorry.
Oh, don't forget the stock teaser.
That's right, never mind. We have terrible problems too. It's not always available.
I know. You just can't get it sometimes. I've got a little packet here.
Maybe I should open up a fresh herb shop.
And as far as the sauce is concerned, I was able to get the Hamisher cucumbers pickled.
Muzzled off, lovely.
And also Mrs. Ellswood's horseradish and beetroot sauce.
So you got it ready-made?
I've got it ready-made,
right,
yes.
If there's a problem and you can't get it ready-made, you can just grate one cooked beetroot and mix it with the pot of horseradish sauce, and you've got the same thing.
Okay, so is that all the ingredients you need?
That's all the ingredients.
That's marvellous. Okay, Schlomo, we'll come back to you in a moment. So that's all you need if you'd like to join in at home as well, cooking up a late night snack recommended by Schlomo. It's going to be turkey schnitzel with potato latkes and some horseradish and beetroot sauce. With any luck, he says, crossing his fingers. Later on...
Unfortunately, I arrived in England. The school term started in September and I arrived in June, so I had 3 months of not knowing anyone and not... you know, being familiar with London or anything. I got terribly miserable and lonely. So my experience of being uprooted and sent away was not a good one. Therefore, when it came time for me to go to Switzerland, I rebelled, thinking, oh no, this is going to be horrible. I've just got used to London. I've just got made friends in the school I've been in.
Okay, who is that then? She has royal links. Her mother was one of the first famous American chat show TV stars, and she starred in an infamous role as Emily. Who is that? We will find out later on. Right, we better make a start then, Schlomo. What are we going to do first?
Right, first of all, you got your turkey schnitzel, your turkey scallop.
Hang on a minute, I'll have to go over to the fridge for that. Right. I've been keeping it in the fridge here. Now, what have we got? Breast slice, is that all right?
That sounds good, nice and fresh.
Oh yes, yes.
Lovely.
Best before the 24th of February. Have I got a chopping board? Yes, got a chopping board here.
Take the veal out of out of the packet.
Okay.
Put it onto your chopping board.
Right.
And Nicholas Wimbledon.
Grinding a fresh black pepper.
I beg your pardon?
A nice spreading of fresh black pepper. You got some pepper?
Oh yes, got some pepper, yeah.
A nice grinding.
Well, I haven't got it on the chopping board yet.
Well, I'm really sorry, I'm working too fast.
Nicholas first.
Yeah.
You have to speed up if you wanted a job in the restaurant, Clive.
All right, do you think I ought to wash it, or is it okay out of the packet?
Give it a quick wash, yeah. Usually it's okay if you've got it from a big supermarket. From a butcher's shop, it's not, because they, by law, they have to wear protective gloves. And
okay. Right, just drain it down a bit there.
And make sure you pat it dry off.
Pat it dry, yes. Daisy, there's a little bit falling off.
They're a bit slippery, aren't they?
They are a bit slippery, yes.
The times they've been on the kitchen floor, we've had to throw them away.
Well, I would hope so too, yeah.
Absolutely, of course.
Okay, it's fairly dry now and it's had a bit of a rinse.
Right, so give it a sprinkling of salt, about a pinch and a half on each side.
A sprinkling of salt?
Yeah.
Okay. Sprinkling of salt. A pinch and a half on each side? A
pinch and a half on each side.
Okay, there we go.
And about 3 or 4 grinds of a peppermill on each side.
Right. Actually, I haven't got the peppermill, but will the already ground do?
No, it was not quite as good, but well, we let you off tonight, Clive.
Okay, there we go. Yep, done that.
Right,
what
have you got a plastic bag or a plastic food bag?
I hope I'm not going too fast for you, by the way. Go on, Schlomo. Have I got a plastic bag, did you say?
Plastic food bag.
Oh, yep.
Yeah?
Yep.
Right, and now, where's the turkey schnitzel at the moment?
It's on the chopping board.
It's on the right.
Just to the left.
Right. Put the bag over on top.
On top?
On top.
Do I put it in the bag?
No. Just place the bag on top.
Why don't I put it in the bag?
Why? Because you don't need to, basically. When you hammer it, you're going to hammer the
schnitzel. I'm going to hammer it
now.
Okay.
And if you put it in the bag, it's hard to get out because it sticks to the inside of the bag.
Right, I've got it on the bag, yeah. I've got it on the chopping board. The bag's on top of it. It's sticking to it already.
Yes, well, that's normal.
Good. What do I do next?
Right. Now, have you got your mallet, your hammer?
I've got a meat tenderizer here,
the
yes.
The one, yes. Now, start from the middle of the schnitzel.
Yes.
And work your way outwards.
What am
just
I doing?
Gently pat it, just gently hammer it. Right, I just hammer it, not beat it to pieces. Right?
Yes. Is that too hard?
A little more gentle.
A little more gentle, okay.
Just gently, and spreading it outwards, if you see what I mean.
Spreading it outwards.
From the middle, working outwards to the outside of the schnitzel. Try not to make any holes in it.
No, it's okay.
It looks terrible on the page if you've got holes everywhere.
Oh, yes, look at that.
Now lift off the bag.
It's spreading out like a... Oh, I could get into this. Yes.
Don't get too carried away.
Now, oh, this is marvellous, yeah.
Stop one moment.
Pardon?
Stop one moment.
It's about double the size now, is that all right?
I'm doing my piece of meat here, making a schnitzel.
Oh, yes.
Not minced turkey.
Right, I've done that.
Take the bag and wet it slightly.
Wet the bag?
Yes, because now it starts to... Have you noticed the bag sticks to the meat a lot?
Yes, it is, isn't it? Yeah.
Right, so if you wet it, it stops that. Okay. Or you can pat some water on top of the schnitzel.
Right.
Right, put the bag back on top and turn the schnitzel over first.
Yeah, turn the schnitzel over. Yep.
Is it still in one piece?
It's still in one piece, yes.
It doesn't sound like it.
No.
Anyway, put the bag back on top.
The wet side?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
And start and give it a bit more of a hammering. It's got to be about a half... Clive, whoa. It has to be about a bit of half an inch thick.
Half an inch thick?
About a quarter to a half in between. I think that might be enough. How's it
Whoops.
Going there?
Went off the edge there. Okay. Yes, I think that's pretty good. It's right. About, yes, between a quarter and a half an inch.
Right, lovely. And it's not, no holes in it?
No holes in it at all, no.
Right, okay.
No, it's a little thin in places.
Right, all right. Now I want you to set it aside. Just put it on a plate. And put
it
aside
on a plate,
for the moment.
Yes.
You want to wash your hands or something, then do that now.
I think I'd better do that, yes.
Nicholas, followed by Neil.
Jaime here always gets very messy doing it as well.
Oh, I know. I know the problem. Right, I've done that. Put it to one side.
Right. Now, I want you to get two of the eggs.
Two of the eggs, yes.
And I want you to crack them into a bowl.
Crack them into a bowl. I've got a sort of mixing bowl, plastic mixing bowl. Would that be all right?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay.
Well, a small bowl. You only need a small bowl.
All right. And I crack them into the bowl.
Yes, and if you want to keep it kosher, you don't add the milk. If you don't mind, it just makes it a bit thinner and holds on to the turkey well if you put some milk into the egg. About a quarter of a cup.
Right.
But you're still on the eggs.
I'm still on the eggs, I'm afraid.
Right,
yeah.
Okay.
I'm trying not to go too fast. I mean, I could just whip this off very quickly, but... Whoa! Whoops-a-daisy. Yes, okay, done that. Got
right.
The eggs in the bowl.
Right.
What do I do next?
Now put in about a quarter of a cup of milk in with the egg.
When you say a cup, what sort of size?
A coffee cup, just a normal teacup, normal coffee cup.
Right. What
I
about
mean, the beauty about this dish?
200 mils, something like that.
Something like that.
Okay. About a quarter of a cup.
Yes.
Okay. Got that.
Right. Can I give it a good whisking?
Oh, I can put it in the bowl yet.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know. You professionals. Right, give it a good whisking.
That's right, put it in the bowl with the eggs and then give it a good whisking.
Okay, here we go. Whoa! Oh dear. No, the propellers have dropped off the end of the whisker.
Where did you buy your equipment?
It's a Kenwood, but I think I pressed the wrong button.
Oh, I see, you got an electric one.
Yes, an electric
one. Technology, Clive.
I know. All right, I've got...
Can't beat the conventional whisk.
How long do I whisk it for?
I'll tell you when. Stop. Lovely, Clive.
Pardon?
That's fine.
Sorry?
Oh, well, Clive, we're trying to make a souffle. We're trying to make a schnitzel here.
Okay.
Right. How do they look?
Well, it's all bubbles.
That's fine. They're settled down. You just need to give it a good mixing. Right, onto another plate.
What do I do with the other egg?
Keep that aside. Not using that at the moment.
Okay.
Saving that for the Latkes.
Right.
Right. So now I want you to get another plate or another shallow dish.
A shallow dish, yes.
And I want you to put the matzo meal in there.
The matzo meal?
About a quarter of a box.
Quarter of a box. A Okay, I'm just opening the medium matzo meal here. What does this do, the matzo meal?
It's going to act as like a bread crumb, but it's a much tastier crumb and doesn't absorb as much oil.
And about a quarter of what's in here?
A quarter of the packet.
Right, about 4 ounces, in fact. Thank you. Oh, the news has just arrived. Thank you very much. That's marvellous. This is the news, is it? The headlines? Great, thank you. Right, I've got about 4 ounces on there.
Right, spread it around on top of the plate.
Spread it around on top of the plate, yes.
And add to it a half a teaspoon of salt.
Half a teaspoon of salt. Uh-huh.
And a half a teaspoon of pepper.
And a half a teaspoon of pepper.
And also 1.5 teaspoons of the mixed thyme.
Oh, hang on, the pepper won't come out. That's better. And some thyme.
And some thyme. 1.5 teaspoons.
1.5 teaspoons of thyme. Have you got the thyme?
I don't actually. I don't know what time it is. Oh, it's about
2 minutes past.
Not the news time yet. Oh, is that what he meant?
Well, you know. Whoa! I've just spilt the matzo meal all over the chopping board.
So just mop it up and throw it away. We've got plenty. You don't need the whole box for this recipe.
No, you don't. Okay, I've got that there.
Right, so you've got the herbs, the salt and pepper and the matzo meal in one party, in one dish.
Oh, smells beautiful.
Is that right?
Yep.
Right, okay. Now with a fork, a dry fork, just give us all that a mix.
Right, I'll just get a fork. It's a plastic one, I'm afraid, but will that do? Just give it a mix.
LBC spend out on these kind of things then, do they? Like to equip your equipment, your kitchen well.
Yes, all the mod cons we've got here. Right.
Right.
Wait for the
ad soon. Plate or a shallow dish.
Yep.
Empty about a quarter of the packet of the flour.
A quarter of the well, I've got a small packet of flour here, 500 grams.
So about half of that.
Half of that, really?
Well, you're not going to use it all. It's just to coat the schnitzel, so you can put it back as after you've finished with it. You're just going to pan it.
Okay. What on? I'm putting this in with the matzo meal?
No, no, you're putting it into a separate plate.
Oh my goodness, I've put it in with the matzo meal.
Have you?
Yes.
Have you mixed it in?
No.
Right, well just try and take off as much as you can.
I will. Oh yes, that's all right. No, it's just skimmed off the top. There's no problem there. Right. Okay.
Right. So you've got the flour on one plate. You've got the matzo meal and herb mix on the other.
Organisation, that's what it's all about, really. So I'm cleaning the chopping board now.
Right.
Now I'm going to put the flour on the chopping board.
Right, why? Because you haven't got another plate?
Well, I've only got paper plates here.
Oh, fine. So put it on the chopping board.
I'll put it on the chopping board.
Right, so you've got the flour on the chopping board.
I've got the flour on the chopping board.
You've got your matzo meal and your herbs and salt and pepper mix in one bowl.
I have, yes.
And you've got your eggs whipped up in the other bowl.
Yep.
And you've got your schnitzel, which is already bashed.
That's right.
And salt and pepper on it. Right, lovely. Now, we're going to set all that aside for the moment, Clive. No, we're not. We're going to... I think it's best, actually, we...
Break.
Schnitzel, get it out the way, and then go on to the Latkes.
All right. Well, what we'll do is give people time to catch up on all that, and we'll do part two of the recipe in just a moment.
I always get to choose the restaurant. That's because I'm right more often than I'm wrong. But it's a big responsibility, which is why I was so delighted to find a Chutney's in London. I haven't been to Chutney's in Bombay.
It's 121 at the moment, just about.
Cuisine, the subtle spices of southern...
We've only got Nicholas and Neil at the moment. I'm going to stick in on the back of this as a haze trail, Jenny Lacey, which is 26 seconds.
There's words like elegant, but it is. And I always pick up the tab.
Okay.
Well, if people like to think it's expensive, who am I to disillusion them? So if you're the person who gets to choose the restaurant, impress someone. Choose Chutney's, Drummond Street, near Euston. Vegetarian Indian cuisine.
I'm Jenny Lacey. Join me tomorrow morning for the Brian Hayes programme as London debates the day's news. Reactions to what's happening in the world on the telephone. Then we meet Toni Morrison.
21 and 15 seconds.
All set in America just as slavery.
Nicholas is from Wimbledon. Neil is from Boreham Wood.
And we'll talk about
less than 10 music fades into prof.
Morning between 10 and 12 here on LBC Radio.
Yes, you can call us now. And it's the headlines quiz, The Making of a Legend. Doctor sets to win TV battle and record break. 3538111. If you'd like to have a go at any of those three, you have to spot the story behind the headline. We're busy making a late night snack in the LBC Radio kitchen as well. And Nicholas is on the phone in Wimbledon. Morning, Nicholas.
Hello, how are you?
I'm a little umbilical this morning. I'm attached by long wires to the studio, and I'm up here in the kitchen.
I'm going for the Doctor headline.
The Doctor set to win TV battle, yes.
As it's the 25th anniversary, I think they're also making a film, and they're probably having a battle with that.
Who are?
The TV series and the film.
Which TV series?
The Doctor Who, sorry, Doctor Who.
So you think it's all about Doctor Who?
Is that wrong?
What would be the TV battle then?
Trying to sort of get more viewers for that, I suppose.
I see what you mean. Not that Doctor, I'm afraid.
Okay, bye.
Thank you for trying. And Neil in Borehamwood. Good morning, Neil.
Hi, Clive, how are you?
I'm umbilical this morning.
Oh,
what about
you? Umbilical. Listen,
yes.
I got your photo through.
I'm sorry.
What a disappointment. We
yes,
have got
I
the
know.
Same colour hair, though.
What colour do you think my hair is?
Well, it looks sort of auburny.
Yeah.
That's exactly
no.
my colour.
Well, it's not quite as auburn as that. I think there's something went wrong with the colour photographs.
Oh, right.
The first time it came out bright red.
Well, it's sort of red at the front.
I know.
You've got like a red ring around
I know, I think it's the photograph.
Oh, anyway, listen.
Yes, Neil. Yes, I'm listening.
Is Shlomo still on the line?
Yes, he's there.
Oh, good, so he can hear this.
Yes.
I've got to tell you something that happened to me.
What happened?
Now, I'm rather partial to a Latke myself. And
you
I
are.
Do know the delicatessens.
Yes.
Around London. And I thought that he said that he phones from Finchley Road. And there's a certain deli, I won't mention the name, on the Finchley Road that I went into, and I vaguely know the owner. He doesn't know me from Adam, but I vaguely know him. And I went in, and I said, Shlomo! Shlomo, I said, give me a Latke! And it wasn't him.
No.
It was definitely not him.
Well, that's where Shlomo lives. I don't know where his restaurant is.
Oh, right. And I was so embarrassed. I had to explain the whole story. And he wasn't even an LBC listener.
Oh, well, he probably is now. So which headline were you going for?
I wasn't. I just wanted to tell you that while Shlomo was listening.
Oh, right.
Because this man denied categorically that he wasn't Shlomo. And I thought...
Didn't know that down here.
Shlomo's listening and maybe he'll deny it.
OK, Neil, thanks very much. Neil in Borehamwood. So a reminder of those headlines. The Making of a Legend is a front page headline on one of the Sunday papers. Doctor set to win TV battle. And record breck 353-8111 if you'd like to have a bash. So we've got the eggs and they're whisked up in the mixing bowl. We've got the schnitzel hammered out to one side, and I've already got the onion
Patrick Forest Gate,
and I've got the chopping board with the flour on it. Patrick is in Forest Gate. Hello, Patrick.
Doctor story.
Yes.
It's about the doctor who's taken a case against one of the national papers in regards of a court case. He was the... his.
Oh, yes, I know what you're talking about. Do you mean the one that the Sun were fined for?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Yeah, it's not that doctor either.
Oh, sorry.
Nice try though, Patrick.
This is the first time I've ever got through.
Congratulations!
And it's the first time I've ever... Rang you up.
Well, you know, you can't be right first time, can
but
you?
But I've been right about a lot of things.
Have you?
In several of your quizzes,
but
yes.
You've not got through?
No.
All right. Thank you, Patrick.
Bye.
Now, I hope you're following the recipe. Shlomo, what do I do next?
Right. Now, I want to get the turkey schnitzel.
Get the turkey schnitzel, yes.
And put it into the flour.
Put it into the flour.
And pat it down.
Oh, it's sticking to the plate. It's a plastic plate, you see. Okay, yes, it's on the flour.
Right, and pat it hard down onto the flour.
Yeah.
Pat it, do I? I didn't bash it, I mean press it.
Pat it?
Press it.
Okay, you've done that.
Right, and now turn it over and do exactly the same.
Right. Done that.
Right, and now I want you to gently pick it up and gently put it into the egg mixture.
The egg mixture?
Into the egg mixture.
Okay, in it goes into the egg mixture.
And it looks
all...
Right, yep. Now take it out.
I can't, it keeps slipping out my hand.
Wrap it over your two fingers so it kind of folds into it. It's much easier
yeah,
like that.
Very good technique, yes. Okay.
Right, and drain it sort of in the bowl. Let it hang over the bowl for a couple of minutes, otherwise you'll put egg everywhere.
Okay, yeah, oh dear me. Shall I wash my hands now?
No, don't do that.
No? What do I do next?
Just gently, just put it on into the matzo meal.
Into the matzo meal?
Leave it on top and go and wash your hands.
Just rest it on the top of the matzo meal.
Rest it on top of the matzo meal and then go and wash your hands.
Okay, I've got the turkey schnitzel resting on the plate full of matzo meal. And I'll just wash my hands.
Make sure they're properly dry as well.
Yes, I will. Right, where do we go from here?
Dry your hands. Okay. Done that?
Just about. Yep.
Right. Scoop some of the meal from underneath the schnitzel on top of it as well, so you're going to give it a really good coating.
Pardon?
Kind of scoop the matzo meal.
Scoop the matzo meal?
From around and underneath the schnitzel.
Yes.
And put it on top of the schnitzel.
Can't I just turn the schnitzel over?
No, because you've got to pat it down hard.
Oh, I see. So I'll need a spoon or something, will I?
Well, you can do it with your hands, your fingers. Just sort of wiggle your fingers
scoop
underneath.
Scoop it all
that
over,
schnitzel.
Yes. Okay, I'm scooping it over.
Right, and give it a really good hard press.
Okay.
Not too hard. Don't squash it.
Right. Yep.
Right. Now,
I haven't quite covered all of it.
Well, turn it over and do exactly the same again.
Right. So turn it over and pat it down.
Yes.
And then do it again on the other side.
Yes.
Well, it's not sticking that much.
Well, that's because you're going to put it back in the egg again.
Oh, am I? Right.
So take it out, shake off any excess crumbs.
Shaking them off, yes.
And put it back into the egg mixture.
And back in the egg mixture.
Dean Ilford.
Right.
And then?
And then?
Make sure everywhere's coated with egg.
It's all covered in egg, yes.
Right, and take it out again.
Got some egg over every bit of it. And then we do what?
Put it back into the matzo meal.
Yes, pat it again.
Yes, if your hands are clean enough.
Oh dear. I've got egg all over them. It's a messy business, this, isn't it?
Our boys here, they've got it down to an absolute art.
Oh, I bet they have,
200 an hour, no mess.
Does it normally take this long? Probably not.
No, we do 200 at a time.
Oh, that's a good rich coating now. Do I have to do it again?
No, just once more.
Right, okay.
And it's evenly coated and it's nice and pressed down.
It looks very good, yes.
Tell me, how's the shape of it, of the schnitzel in general?
Well, it's got a little bit sticking out the end, but otherwise it's fairly oblong.
Obviously, when you're banging it down, the importance of keeping it to a nice round shape.
You've got to have it looking right, really, haven't you?
Well,
yes.
When it's on the plate, it all helps. Right, anyway, put the schnitzel aside. Put it onto a plate and just set it aside for a moment.
Right, I shall put it back on one of our LBC paper plates. Yep. And next?
Right, you've got... Now, get a couple of your cucumbers. Pickled cucumbers.
Oh, the pickled cucumbers, yes.
Take two out of two the same size. Medium, not too big.
I can't open the jar.
Stick it under the hot tap for a minute. It always works.
Oh, no, it's done. So a couple of these cucumbers.
Both the same size, if you can.
Both the same size. I can't get them out of the jar. Yeah, there we are. Yes.
Right.
Okay.
Now, I want you to put them onto the surface with a knife.
Yes.
Now, I want you to imagine... Lengthways, slicing it lengthways, but I don't want you to slice the whole length. I want you to leave it at the top so that it's going to cut about 5/8 of the way up. Do you see what I mean?
Yes, I do, yes.
Right, and make about 6 slices like that, not the whole length of the cucumber.
So you leave it solid at the top, but...
Solid at the top, sliced along the rest.
Sliced along the rest, yes, lengthways.
And if you lay it out on the table and give it a press gently with the palm of your hand, you'll find it creates a nice fan shape.
I'm doing this with two of them, am I?
Doing that, yes. It's for garnish. Schnitzel's not the same without your Hamish of cucumbers.
Oh, yes, I think I've got the trick of this now. Yeah, so we fan this out.
That's right, and you set those aside because they're going to be used as a garnish.
Been before the news.
All right, then, I've got that.
Right, now on to the Latkes.
On to the Latkes.
So you need your three potatoes.
Three potatoes,
and your grater.
And the grater.
Got an electric one, or are you going to do it by hand?
No, I've got it by hand, yes.
Have you got good muscles?
Grating four potatoes, yes.
Do it fast. The faster the better, less painful.
Right, I'm grating away.
Right, I hope you're not doing it on the one with the thick grating.
Oh, I am actually, yes.
I would do it on the one that's thinner.
On the thinner one, yep.
Or mixed, if it's a very fine one, do it on a mixture of the two.
Oh, I think it'll, yes. It's getting a bit mushy on the thin one. I'll have to use the thick one, I think.
You've got to squeeze out the water anyway.
Oh, have you?
Oh, yes.
Oh,
okay. I tried with all the water.
Right, well, I'll carry on doing this and I'll have a word with Dean on the headlines quiz next. Hello, Dean. Good morning.
Good morning.
Which one are you going for?
The making of relations.
The which one?
The Making of a Legend.
Oh, The Making of a Legend, yes. What do you reckon that's about?
It's about Robert Maxwell and his life story.
Well, it might well be. Which paper would you have seen that on?
Well, I haven't. I took a guess right from the news.
Yeah, you're spot on. I have to tell you, well done. You're obviously paying attention, weren't you?
Yeah.
Yes, well done. That's exactly what it's about. That is, believe it or not, the front page headline on the Sunday Mirror, The Making of a Legend, and it's all about the life of Robert Maxwell because of that book. So here's your prize question.
Yeah.
Where was he born? That was on the news as well. He's very well known for it.
I've forgotten now. It's completely gone from my mind.
I think I should have got a food processor. You're not going to get it, are you?
Nah.
It's Czechoslovakia.
Yeah, I knew it sounded like that.
Oh, you knew it all along, didn't you? Oh, well, never mind, but well done.
Okay.
Well done for getting that far. So two headlines remaining. Doctor set to win TV battle and record break. Nobody's had a go at that one yet. Record break. 353-8111. More calls after the news. If you're longing for
somewhere new, don't worry now. Why just keep longing for your ideal holiday when you can discover it in Dalton's Weekly? Turn to Dalton's Weekly and you'll find thousands of holidays all over Britain. Hotels, cottages, caravans, self-catering accommodation. Britain's biggest choice, up to the minute every week. So ask your newsagent for Dalton's Weekly and discover your dream in Dalton's.
This is Clive Bull, and in the news this morning, another Palestinian has been shot dead by the Israelis during disturbances on the West Bank. This time it's a 12-year-old boy who's been killed. Irish Premier Charles Haughey says security cooperation between the Republic and Britain on Northern Ireland could be in jeopardy if there's not what he describes as fair play in the administration of justice in Ulster. And at least 150 people appeared dead after torrential rain flooded Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, causing mudslides and turning streets into rivers 5 feet deep. The weather in town, cloudy but dry, the minimum 7 Celsius, 45 Fahrenheit in town, 5 degrees 41 out of town. The day ahead, cloudy and dry, sunny spells and mild. Top temperature 12 Celsius, 54 Fahrenheit.
Okay.
Magazine every Thursday.
Good evening, Clive. We haven't got much in the way of calls at the moment.
Most cars than all of your local papers put together.
We'll go back to Schlomo.
Just 30 pence. Car buyer for car buyers. At your newsagents now.
Thinking of buying a sofa bed? Then listen.
Sofa to bed, sofa to bed.
At Sofa to Bed, Bayford Street, Hackney, our first.
Right, Lisa from Golders Green.
On the premise
for Schlomo.
Fabric you choose, and we don't use the high fire risk polyurethane foam. I repeat, we don't use the high fire risk polyurethane foam at no extra cost to you. Get a safer sofa bed from
Sofa to Bed.
Come and see us at Bayford Street, off Mare Street.
Bye.
01 533 0915.
This is Dorothy from Cockfosters.
Waving you up.
I listen regularly every night to Clive Bull.
Right, that's got the flour off the chopping board. I've grated quite a bit of potato, but I think I'm going to have to grate a bit more. So who have we got on the headlines quiz next? I wonder.
Lisa.
I beg your pardon?
Lisa.
Lisa it is, yes. Hello, Lisa.
Hello.
Hello, Lisa. Which headline are you going for?
For the record break.
Record break, yes. Yes. What do you think that's about?
Well, I heard that there's going to be a Madonna concert, which is they're going to make a record out of it. Is that right?
A Madonna concert, and they're going to make a record out of it?
Yeah.
So where would the break bit come in?
I don't know.
So you're just using record as a bit of a clue?
Yeah.
Well, you may well be right, but I'm afraid that's not the right headline.
Oh,
what's that? Oh, never mind. Thanks, Lisa.
Okay.
Thank you for calling.
Percy Milton Keynes.
353-8111 is
Percy.
And it's Percy next. Hello, Percy.
Good
Good morning, Claude.
Good morning.
Yeah, I spoke to tell you with your chicken.
I'm a little bit umbilical this morning. I'm on the end of a big long wire.
I'm speaking from Milton Keynes. I spoke to you some while back, Clive.
Oh yes.
Well, and you said what a lovely clear line I got.
It was marvellous. Yes.
Well, I'll tell you what the advert is about, Clive. Not the advert. The
advert. Do excuse me grating the potatoes, won't you? I'm sorry about this.
No. What I mean.
But I've got to get these done, really.
No, the headline. I mean.
Yes, the headline.
Yes, the headline, Clive. Yeah. It's to do with the break.
The break. Ready break. Record break.
A record break. Yeah. I think it's to be said to the commercial. Commercial advertising, Clive.
In what way?
Well, the morning cereals.
Yes. It's something to do with morning cereals.
Mary in Morden.
Well, it's the morning. I can't really add to it. Am I close, Clive?
You're not close enough, I'm afraid. You're along the right lines with the business of the morning cereal, but I'm afraid you're not close enough.
Not close enough, Clive.
But nice to talk to you again from Milton Keynes.
It's a lovely line, isn't it?
It's brilliant, yes. Here am I, standing in a kitchen, and there you are in Milton Keynes. Whereabouts are you in the house?
Well, in the living room, Clive.
In the living room, right.
Which best place to be?
I think, yes. It could be right there. Thank you, Paul.
Mary Morden.
Thank you very much indeed. Off to Morden now, and here's Mary. Hello, Mary.
Hi, Clive.
Hi.
Oh, God, I don't get it wrong. Isn't there in EastEnders, the doctor in EastEnders?
The doctor in EastEnders?
Yeah.
I'm afraid it's not.
Oh, God, I know.
Sorry.
All right, love. Bye.
Bye-bye, love.
Pedro Enfield.
Let's try Pedro in Enfield. Hello, Pedro.
Good morning. I am a friend of Manolo.
Ah, yes.
From.
He's Pedro.
From Toledo.
Ah, from Toledo.
See. He told me, telephone Cliff Bull.
Cliff? Is Cliff.
Cliff Bull.
He's
Clive Bull.
That's the one, yes.
I come to London, because he say you speak English very well, and you tell Cliff that I say hello.
Oh, that's nice. How is Manolo at the moment?
Well, he is not so happy because his grandmother she not very well.
Oh, I know. No improvement then?
No, she is not improved yet.
But your English sounds pretty good, Pedro, really.
Yeah, I have a study in Londres for 4 years.
Yes.
Apagar la radio, por favor.
Roger in Harrow.
A Cambridge certificate.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, you are doing well then, aren't you? Yeah. Did you want to have a go at a headline at all?
Yeah, I thought the record break.
Record break, yes.
Is the to do with the Guinness Book of Records.
The Guinness Book of Records.
Yeah. Someone with to try and break the record. For how many one could break in 1 hour?
Well, you're very close. Funnily enough, you'll discover how close you are shortly.
Uh-huh.
Not right, though, Pedro. But it's good to talk to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Do send my regards to Manolo.
Clive Bull.
Yes, that's the one. Schlomo, I think I've... I've just about grated the potatoes now.
Right, well, you've got to start grating again, I'm afraid. You've got to do the onion now.
Oh, no.
But it's much easier, Clive. It's like water.
What, grating the onion?
Yes, watch your eyes. Keep the tap running. If it starts to hurt your eyes, you look at the running water.
I'm going to be crying here.
Roger Harrow next.
I'm going to just rinse out the grater as well, do you think?
No, you don't have to, because it goes into the same pot as the potato.
Oh, does it? Okay, right.
And you grate it into the potato.
So we grate it into the potato?
Yeah.
A whole onion?
How big is it?
Well, it's about the size of a bit smaller than a tennis ball.
And how big is it in comparison to one of your potatoes?
A little bit smaller.
Fine, use the whole onion.
Use the whole onion. Okay. I shall get on with this. And who have we got next on the headlines quiz?
Roger.
Roger, hello.
Hello, Clive.
Hello.
I was going to have a go at the doctors and TV.
Yes.
I believe it's BBC Two, after closed down, being rented by a commercial company, making programmes for doctors to record out of hours.
Ah, no, I've heard about that story, and it has got the go-ahead now, hasn't it?
I don't know, but I suppose that if you're saying it's wrong, it hasn't.
Well, I'm afraid to say it's not right, Roger.
Jolly good.
Leslie next.
Good luck with your meal.
Well, thank you. It seems to be... Oh dear, it's these onions, I'm sorry.
Yes, you'll have little pieces of finger in the end in a minute.
Oh don't, yes, I've caught my finger once on this already.
Yes, I don't think it's kosher. not to have too much finger in the
You're not kidding, Roger.
Right.
I'm trying my best here, though.
Yeah.
Thanks for the call.
Okay.
Leslie.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
I'm sorry, they're making me cry, these onions. Which headline are you going for?
About the doctor.
The doctor, yes.
Yeah, is it the plastic surgeon?
The plastic surgeon, which one?
The one that was on the London programme the other night.
Oh yes, I saw that. It's quite an interesting programme. I'm afraid it's not that doctor either.
Born from Streatham.
Thanks.
Thanks for the try. Oh dear me. I'm going to have to put the tap on. I'm sorry about this. The onions are really getting to me now. Hello, Sean.
Yes. you're not serious, are you? I mean, you're not really stuck in the kitchen doing all that.
Well, of course I am. Where do you think I am? Listen, here's the sink.
Yeah. No, I can tell by the sound quality, actually. You're not in the studio.
No, that's right.
Yeah.
And the cooker while, over here.
While Schlomo's on the phone to you,
who's just dropped
the
off.
Store?
Say that again.
While Schlomo's on the phone to you constantly, who's minding the store?
Well, he's at the store.
I know, but who's minding it? You know, if somebody wants something done, he's on the phone to you.
I think he said he had Jaime there as well.
Oh, right.
Looking after things.
Constantine Streatham next.
Right, I think I've actually missed out on it because somebody else has mentioned something which I didn't hear, and you said he was near to it, but I'll have a go at my idea. The brick. Idea.
Yes.
I think possibly they had a poll on what is the most popular breakfast cereal for kiddies, and they've come up with one.
Ah, well, yes, that would fit as well. You are very close, but
well,
I'm afraid...
I can't mention the product, but...
well, you can mention the product. You can mention the product.
Well, probably Ready Breck, I don't know.
Well, it is something to do with that, but I'm afraid you're not close enough.
Not close enough.
No, sorry.
Okay, bye.
Thank you for trying, Sean. So, a quick reminder of those two headlines remaining. Record Breck and Doctor sets to win TV battle. I've just about mixed up the onions and the potato. I shall just give it a little whisk and we'll have a word with Constantine. Hello.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning. Excuse my voice. Record Breck.
Yes.
Would that have anything to do with TV AM? In that, despite the fact that they have not had the services of the technicians for several months, they're still the number one morning programme on the television.
Oh, I see, yes. I'm afraid that's not right.
Rick Ludgate Circus.
Constantine, thank you for trying. Some inspired guesses coming through on the headlines quiz. Rick is next. Hello, Rick.
Hello there, mate.
Hello, mate.
How are you going?
Well, I'm struggling here with me...
Are you crying your eyes out?
Yes, I know.
Anyway, I want to ask someone about the doctor.
The doctor, yes.
Yeah, I've got the answer, but I can't find the bit in the paper.
Try me.
It's the one on the Jack the Ripper.
Oh, yes.
They reckon it's some quack that's the guilty one.
Oh, I see what you mean. It's a doctor that is really Jack the Ripper.
Yeah, they've got a list of people who are possible suspects, and they've nailed him down as the man.
Well, that is one that Colin Wilson's going to be talking about. But where would the TV battle be, then?
Oh, I didn't hear that bit.
Oh, dear, Rick!
What can I say?
What can you say?
They're probably going to do a serial on it, Hard to Follow Neighbours.
Oh, yes. Well, something's got to follow Neighbours, hasn't it? Not right, Rick.
Anyway, best for your meal.
Thank you.
Cheers, mate.
Amanda in Hampstead.
Amanda, let's try Amanda. Hello?
Hello.
Hampstead. Hello.
Well, I want to answer about the doctor.
with a TV.
Yep.
Well, I think it's something to do with a nurse's strike and a doctor who's trying to get to TV to show everyone how difficult it is for the doctors to have the nurses now.
So where would the TV battle be exactly?
Well, it could be a head doctor trying to get onto the TV news.
It could be, but I'm afraid you're not right.
Ad break next.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Sorry. Not even close, no. 1:45, and we'll have more calls coming.
I always get to choose the restaurant. That's because I'm right more often.
Clive, do you want to go to the comedy?
It's a big responsibility.
I think, we, you know, it's 47:15 at the moment.
I haven't been to Chutney's in Bombay, but I've been to the one in L.A., and I enjoy the light, delicate cuisine, the subtle spices of southern India. Totally vegetarian, of course. And it's not just the food. The place looks good. I hate to use words like elegant, but it is. And I always pick up the tab real quick. Well, if people like to think it's expensive, who am I to disillusion them? So if you're the...
Chutney's Indian cuisine.
Impress someone. Choose Chutney's, Drummond Street, near Euston. Vegetarian Indian cuisine.
We've got an ambitious project going at the moment. This is Clive Bull. I'm in the LBC Radio kitchen, and I'm preparing a meal with the help of Schlomo Finchley. I've got my Turkish schnitzel in its matzo meal waiting on one side, and also the pickled...
Schlomo's up.
And I've got the bowl full of shredded potato and onion. So what do I do next, Schlomo?
As I tell you, if it took Jaime this long to make a schnitzel and latkes, I would have lost my customers.
I'm sorry, you know, I've got a radio program to run here as well.
I'm sure. You're doing very well, Clive.
Am I? Is there anything I can be getting on with now?
Well, what I wanted to do now is you've got to try and get rid of all the water. It looks a bit slushy, doesn't it?
It does, yes, yes.
Right, well, you've got to grab it in your hand in like balls, and you've got to squeeze out all the water into the sink.
Oh, no, really?
You should be able to do it in about 4 or 5 handfuls.
4 or 5 handfuls. Then do I keep them in the balls?
No, you just throw it all back into the bowl. It's going to be mixed.
It's going to be mixed,
doesn't have to catch in balls. It's just like that. It's easier to get rid of all the excess water.
Well, I'll be getting on with that whilst we have a spot of vintage comedy. And you may remember we're in the company of Tony Hancock and his rather imaginative war memories.
And so there you were in the heart of Germany.
Yes. Wasn't a very good start, I'm afraid.
Why not?
We landed right in the middle of a prisoner of war camp. Anyway, of course, we explained to the commandant that we were...
It's not for long for you to get down to do the news, is there?
Decent enough fella, he saw me point. Well, he was a Rhodes Scholar. I mean, he was educated at Oxford. He knew London very well. He had a lot of friends in England.
The outside's 59.05, but I can bring that back a little bit.
And what I thought of the chances at Wimbledon that year. Now, the man was practically English himself.
Yeah, so what did he do?
He came across there with a rifle butt and threw me in a cell.
That's a good idea.
He condemned you to be shot as spies.
That is exactly what he did do. We were to be executed 3 days later. It's no good. We must get in touch with London. James, have you finished making that radio set?
Yes. I use a corned beef tin, 2 pieces of wire, a razor blade, a German Erionate valve, and a torch battery.
Ingenious. Does it work?
No. How can you possibly make a radio set out of that rubbish?
Then we'll just have to escape, that's all. Now, who's had experience at digging tunnels?
I have, sir. The Regent Street Bank, Joe. The Lombard Street Post Office and Dartmoor to Plymouth. 36, 37 and 39.
Good man. Kerr, did you keep the knife and fork from dinner time?
Yes, sir. Here they are.
Right, give them to James. Start digging the tunnel under your bed.
A knife and fork's no good to me, sir. I don't know how to use them. I always use a spoon and a crust of bread to shove it on with.
Pity. We'll have to think of something else then.
I know. Albert R.N.
Pardon?
Look, we make a dummy. Then the next time we go out on recreation, we take a bit each under our shirt. Then while we're outside, one of us gets away and the other two put the dummy together and come back inside the camp. So when the Germans count us, there's 3 of us still. You buffoon. You ace buffoon. If there's 2 of us left and 1 dummy, that means for the next one to escape, we've got to make another dummy. And when the 3rd one gets away, we're going to have 3 dummies helping each other in and out of the camp. Well, why don't we just stop here and wait for the war to finish?
We're getting shot on Wednesday.
Hey, wait a minute. Look, I've got it. We'll jump on three guards, pinch their uniforms, and just stroll out of the camp, casual-like.
What a good idea. You great oaf. Steal some German uniforms. We're in a British prisoner of war camp now. I say, you there, we're British.
Yeah, that's what they all say. Shot at dawn.
Here, I know. Let's jump on three guards, pinch their uniforms, and just stroll out of the camp, casual-like.
What another good idea. Back where we started. They didn't even notice we've gone.
By order of the Führer, leader of the Third Reich, you have been sentenced to be shot. The sentence will now be carried out. Have you anything to say?
I have.
Yeah?
When you give the order to fire, please don't shout. I've got a bit of a headache.
You're a foolish, brave Englander. You have that supreme courage that only foreign dogs admire in you English people. Fall in. Quick march.
This is it, chaps. Stiff upper lips. I regret that I have but one life to give for my country.
Fire! How on earth did you manage to escape death?
Ah, well, you see. One thing the Germans overlooked was the fact that we were all heavy smokers. We each had six cigarette cases concealed on our persons, and each one stopped a bullet. When the Germans came to see if we were dead, I jumped up, overpowered them, shot the rest of the firing squad, released the other prisoners, and with me at the head, we marched on Berlin. Got there just before the Russians, captured the city, had tea at the Kremlin with Stalin. Came back home, and to this day, nobody ever knew. Nobody ever knew. Isn't it marvellous? And that is why I have no photographs of myself between 1939 and 1945.
When I first saw the script, it wasn't a soft porn film. It was only tagged as a soft porn film some 12 years after it had been made. And actually, at the time when I saw the original script, a lot of the scenes which were later incorporated into it weren't in the original script. I did have reservations. Even so, of course, I had reservations about doing it, and my main reservation was, could I take on a leading role in a film, which is what it was. It was the lead role in a film.
Your acting career continued. I mean, obviously, one thing everybody knows about you, your private life completely swamped the career in 82. You had a relationship with an extremely public figure. Was it difficult after that, getting that career back on the rails? Were you thought of as coup stark non-actress because of all the headlines you've been making for another reason?
Well, I don't know how I was viewed. It's very difficult for one person to...
Clive!
...determine how other people view you. All I know is that, yes, it was...
Clive, don't forget to plug your mic back in.
It was impossible for me to get representation because because of this unchristian attitude that the press had, it's difficult for anybody, producers and directors that were seriously thinking of putting on a good production. If they had been associated with me, anything I was associated with at the time attracted an enormous amount of publicity. And because of this this tag to my name, it would have brought serious productions into disrepute. And the only sort of work I had been offered, was offered at the time, was the exploitation of that particular image which the press were creating.
With hindsight, do you regret that part of your life? Do you wish now it hadn't happened?
It's
jolly good.
I mean, at the moment I'm working, I'm doing a play.
Cue to a break, next dish, if you want. Question, okay. I'll leave. That's so tennis.
To be working, I'm thrilled with the production, and I'm over the moon about it. It's so difficult for me to say, you know...
That's 10. Paula's getting abusive phone calls all the time down here.
...happened to my life. All I can tell you is that today...
You're philosophical about it. You think, yeah, I'm happy enough now.
Yeah.
Gough Stark talking to Mark Smith. I'm back here in the LBC radio kitchen and we'll be cooking up our late night snack in just a moment.
Methuselah lived to 120 years old.
Bill followed by Jenny.
From the dead.
It's okay.
So join me, Lawrence Spicer, at
Schlomo next
evening.
Right, just putting the finishing touches to our meal. Now we have to actually cook it. I've done the preparation. Shlomo?
Right, so how's the potato mix looking?
Oh, it's good. It's amazing how much liquid comes out of potatoes and onions.
You lose it at least a half, so now you can see it's not that profitable after all. Latkes.
It's not, is it, really? No.
You lose half of your quantity.
You're quite right, it's
so
gone
it's nice
down.
It's dry now, is it, the mix?
Well, it's sort of soggy, not that
right.
dry.
Okay, well, if you put the oil into the frying pan now.
The oil into the frying pan.
Now I want
okay.
you to put it on to heat.
Okay.
On a gentle. Are you cooking on gas or electricity?
I've got it electric here. Yes.
Right. So put it on number four for the minute.
Number four. Okay.
One of the rings, of course.
Yes, on one of the rings. And how much oil?
So it's about 1.5 inches deep.
1.5 inches deep.
You're semi-deep frying.
This is going to be deep, isn't it?
You probably need all the oil.
I probably will.
How big's the saucepan, the frying pan?
It's about a foot around.
You've got a 12-incher?
I've got a 12-inch frying pan here, yes.
Right, well, you probably need all the... what size bottle of oil have you got?
Oh, my goodness, it's all going in there. About a litre.
Right.
I'm not going to use all that.
Well, you can use it again afterwards.
Can you? Okay. All right, I've got about an inch in there. Is that okay?
Yeah, a bit more.
A little bit more, okay.
You can always use it again in future. You can make 20 schnitzels from one bottle of oil.
Okay, I've got it in there.
Right, now put it on gently to heat.
Yep, got meanwhile, it on... Whoops-a-daisy, sorry. I've got it on number four, yes.
Meanwhile, I want you to put...
Trip crack, over my umbilical cord here. Okay, go on.
To crack one egg into the potato mix.
Crack one egg into the potato mix. Hang on a second. Right.
Then I want you to put about 6 heaped tablespoons of the motto meal in as well.
In goes the egg into the potato and the onions, and then how many of motto meal?
About a cup.
About a cup.
Well, try 3/4 at first, because it depends on how wet the potatoes are.
Can I use the motto meal we were using before?
Yes, of course.
With the spices in it?
Yes.
What is a cup?
It's difficult to know what you mean by a cup, though, but I've got one that's slightly smaller than a big coffee mug.
We'll put about 3/4 in at first.
Okay.
And then...
mix it up.
Yes, a bit of salt and pepper. A
bit of salt and pepper, yep. And the egg.
And is it quite firm now?
It's firming up very nicely now, yes.
Right.
Yes,
keep mixing it.
Yep.
And I want you to put the... oil to heat a bit higher now. You've got to get it a bit
I enjoyed hot. The bit with the turkey schnitzel, though, and the meat tenderizer. Yes, is there anything more to do on that?
It sounded like you liked it. I thought
yes.
you were killing the piece of meat.
Yes. Okay.
No more to do with that, though, I'm afraid. You've got some patting out to do in your hands.
Some patting out in the hands.
You've got to make the latkes into...
oh, this is firming up very nicely now.
Lovely. It's the expansion of matzo meal.
Yes, it is, isn't it? Yes. Oh, that's very, very good consistency. It's sort of clinging together a little bit.
Lovely. Sounds like you're going to make a good latke. I'll be proud of you.
What do I do next?
Right, I want you to make 2 latkes by making them in the palm of your hand, circle shape, about 4 inches across. And they've got to be about less than half an inch thick.
Less than half an inch thick, but about 4 inches across.
And circle.
Okay.
2 of those.
Less than half an inch thick, my goodness. So a bit like a sort of beef burger, really.
Yes.
That sort of shape.
Slightly... fatter though,
slightly fatter, yes.
I mean, the thinner you make them, the crispier they get as well.
Oh, I think I'd like them crispy, yes.
So make it quite thin.
Can I pat them out on the chopping board?
Well, no, don't get carried away again. And that way, anyway, they fall apart when you fry them if they're too thin.
Oh dear, you're quite right, yes. Okay, shall I slip this in the oil now?
No, first of all, check the temperature of the oil by dropping a teeny bit of the spare latke mix. Check if it goes in and sizzles. If it doesn't, the oil's not quite hot enough.
Okay, here we go. No, it didn't do anything.
Right, turn the electric right up, get it nice and hot.
Get it nice and hot. It's gone up to 6 now.
That's
it's getting warmish. Should I take the little bit of mixture out?
Mixture
then
out
again,
of where?
Thermodynamic laws, commonly known
no,
as...
not
you can't
now, Daryl, later on, eh? Thank you. Right. So we'll let the oil heat up. And whilst we're waiting for that, I'll have a word with Bill, who's on the phone now. Hello, Bill. Good morning.
Hello. Clive.
Yes.
Is it Clive? Yes.
Yes, it is. Is that Bill?
I'm Bill of Bounds Green.
Bill.
I think you may know me. I've often phoned.
Well,
the thing is about
reputation
Ronnie...
reputation precedes you.
Yeah, I don't want to keep you long. The thing is, Ronnie Barker.
Yes.
Now, I was disappointed when I learned after he'd been on
Rogan's show.
Yes.
But I found out all about it because he's writing his autobiography in a daily paper. May I name which one?
Of course you can. It's the Daily Mail, isn't it?
That's right. Have you heard? Did you know?
Yes, I've seen it.
Oh, yeah, good. Well, I thought I was...
That's right, he had an exclusive, so the Sun whipped up another story.
Oh, did they?
The Sun phoned him up and said, could we do a story about you?
Oh, yes, I think he wrote about that.
And he said, no, I've got an exclusive.
Yes.
So the Sun said, well, could we have one too?
Yes.
So he had to explain a little about the basics of journalism and what exclusive means.
Yeah, I didn't... the trouble is, Clive, I think he's a wonderful man, as we all do, and I was disappointed. However, I've got the full set laid on one side, ready to read. I've been so busy, I haven't had time to settle down and read it.
Well, he's probably had an interesting life. I haven't read all of it either, I imagine it would make good reading. Better reading than the front page story on The Sun.
Oh, of course. Yeah, I agree. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Glad to be of service.
Bye-bye.
Let's just check, see how the oil's...
Jenny next.
Need to slip in a little bit of the Latke mixture just to see if it's sizzling, and...
Jenny, and get a move on with this recipe.
Right, Jenny, hello.
Hello, good morning to you, Clive.
Good morning.
How are you doing with the Latkes? You're having a tough time.
Oh, it's hard work, you know, this cooking, isn't it?
Well, you see what we Jewish women go through.
That's right.
To feed our men.
That's right. What did you want to say?
I wonder what sort of matzo meal you're using. Are you using the fine or the medium?
The medium, yes.
Yes, that's right. And the soya bean oil?
That's right.
Oh, that's very good. Oh, he's teaching you the right way.
Oh, yeah. Well, he recommended that, although I've got sunflower oil at the moment.
Oh, I see. But I buy the soya bean because it's even, I consider it to be better. You have to be very careful and make sure you drain them very well afterwards.
Oh, I know. I'm going to have to do that, yes.
Yes, because, no content of oil. By the way, I don't know if he mentioned it to you, but, there's a wonderful wine that goes with it. Heimischer cucumbers, latkes and schnitzel.
Yes.
And a lovely Pelwin number 4 wine.
Really?
Oh.
That sounds good.
You have a dinner divine.
Mm-hmm.
But you surely, can you eat latkes at this time of the morning?
I can eat anything at this time of the morning, yes.
A cast iron tummy, have you?
Oh, well, you see, when you're operating in a few hours delay,
yes.
Then this is really my dinner time.
Do you manage to get a meal before you start your program?
Sandy. Hmm? Say that again?
Do you have a meal before you start your program?
A little bit earlier than that, because I'm busy preparing the program, so...
Do you have a mummy or a wife to look after you?
Well, I've got a mummy, most of us have, but...
Yes, of course.
This is the idea, you see, I'm learning how to cook myself.
Oh, we'll have to find you... Well, I have a nice girl for you. To go with the wine and the schnitzel and the latkes.
Jenny?
Well, I'm not going to sing to you this time.
Right.
I'm sure you must be pleased about that.
Leave me your phone number. I shall get on with these latkes then.
Yes, have a good time.
Thank you.
And tell me the next time if they're really delicious.
I will.
I tell you something, I make latkes, but I use one more ingredient.
Yes,
which
that?
Makes them very light as well.
Oh, yes.
But what's I can't that? Tell it to you on the phone because I don't want Schlomo to know. It's my secret.
Oh, it's your secret ingredient.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Jenny.
God bless.
And Schlomo, what do you think that secret ingredient might be then?
I don't know. It could be the use of flour.
Oh, yes.
I mean, sometimes that in the place of matzo meal can make a lighter latke, but...
Now, this oil is sizzling. I better put them in.
Lovely. Put the latkes in, not the schnitzel.
No. I'm going to have to stand back, I think, though. It may sizzle rather a lot.
Well, turn the oil down to number 4 now.
Oh, yes, sizzling away.
Have you turned the oil down?
No, I haven't turned it down
yet.
Well,
just in case, it might get a bit too hot.
It might get a bit too hot.
Before you know it.
Okay, I'll turn it down to 4.
By the way, Powin's number 4. It is. It's ideal with a schnitzel.
Is it really?
The lovely Israeli red wine. Very nice.
Sounds fantastic. So we've got that going. What are we doing with the schnitzel? We have to wait for that,
do we? That has to wait, because the latkes are going to take a bit longer than the schnitzel to cook.
Okay, I'm just getting some paper out here for draining the latkes, because I'll have to get all this grease off, won't I?
Yeah, you'll find with the schnitzel, you won't get quite as much oil because the matzo meal doesn't absorb as much as breadcrumbs, for example.
Okay.
The schnitzel's no problem, but the latkes, you have to make sure they're very well drained.
Right.
You can do that with greaseproof paper.
How long are they going to be in the oil, then?
Latkes are about 3 minutes each side. And
three
you put the schnitzel in on the last 3 minutes when you turn them over.
Okay.
Or just after then.
Well, they're sizzling away very nicely, so I'll leave them for a couple of minutes.
Don't let them get too burnt underneath.
No, I shan't. And I shall turn them over in a couple of minutes' time. And in the meantime, Domestic appliances is our topic, and it's a subject that Barney Burnham has been investigating.
Sounds we know and love, all of them coming from appliances developed over the past century. With
well, we've had a few callers. Well, we've had actually about one, I think. But is that the general opinion? No, number one, there's no general calls coming through, and one lady or someone's phoned in and said, oh, for God's sake, you know, just why can't you just go out and buy the bloody thing? It's terrible listening to this.
Spend.
So, anyway, plug for some calls,
yeah.
And I think maybe it's best that we sort of try and get these latkes out the way as soon as we can.
I mean, you have jobs outside.
Yes, and make sure we bring something down.
But if...
But it's, maybe they think because you're there, it's the fact they can't... ring you in anywhere, because I said just now, well, so what's the problem at the moment? You've got a general call going up there, but maybe it's just you're not plugging the calls.
Okay, no, I
think sideline is that the
could be it. Maybe
I
they just think that
either.
No, that's true.
Like at weekends, almost as if they want to
discuss French tourism.
Is how much housework they do.
Doubtless.
It's nostalgia street.
Boy aimed at the soft under of the partners.
Yes.
Let's look at a huge variety of labour-saving devices.
No, I think it sounds very good.
Used water power a lot. For example, there's an attachment from your tap to your sewing machine that you could actually work a sewing machine.
Gardening with Jim.
It's attached to the base of a sewing machine. That always fascinated me. They also had one...
Pornographic phone calls, was it?
Do lots of things with one machine, because giving a...
We've got Moulin Rouge, gardening, horticulture, theatre, French tourism, domestic work, nostalgia streets. I don't know.
You could peel potatoes in it, wash your clothes in it, wash your dishes in it as well. It even played a radio. I'm not quite sure how that happened, but it had a motor which was, you know, infinitely adaptable.
If it could also darn socks, polish shoes and clean windows, so much the better. But the rise of the household appliance came when people began to find that servants were a luxury.
You could at that point have improved external services. For example, the first vacuum cleaner came round like window cleaners, a great machine, horse-drawn, pipes that came through your windows with men in white overalls hoovering all round your room. And you, there were these sort of wonderful vacuum cleaner tea parties where you invited your friends round and showed them, watch these. I'd love it now. Would you imagine two white-coated men coming around and vacuuming your house for you? And similarly, people use laundries rather than doing their own washing. Now, in a sense, by substituting for those servants, little individual machines, they seemed wonderful at the time, and now that everyone can afford them, they still sort of seem wonderful. But what we've done is break up all our household tasks into little bits that we have to do hundreds of little things. Instead of, I mean, the window...
Yeah-ish.
...one. Why don't we do that with lawn mowing?
Why not indeed? Why not take in all sorts of nasty chores? Mr. and Mrs. Herbert Higginbottom cordially invite you to take part in the ceremonial unblocking of their drain and servicing of Granny's commode. But what, as they say, about the future?
I think people will have far fewer machines in their homes in 100 years' time. It'll come to the door. It'll be delivery again.
And are there any extraordinary new appliances which are about to explode onto the market that you're aware of?
Well, the one that domestic appliance sort of inventors are most interested in is the robot. And to me, that's just a backward step. That's, again, you know, having this silly little robot that wheels through with your orange juice in its arm. And or you can tell it to do simple tasks. Again, you're...
Okay, that's 10, Clive.
I think you want to shift out of the home. Give people jobs providing services. It's a much better idea.
Amen to that.
Sorry, it's about a minute, actually.
General public like to see in the future.
I would like a household appliance that puts my knickers in the right drawer, my sweaters in the right drawer, my socks in the right drawer, and hangs up my clothes.
I'd just like a household appliance that does nearly what Jill wants, but just can sort the dirty things from the clean things on my drawer.
Pete could give the number out.
Or something like that.
I'd like some
Clive?
That fits
Murray.
Through the mail slot on your front door and filters out the junk mail before it even comes through the door, so that only the comes through the mail slot. The rest is rejected and lands back on the doorstep.
What I'm really looking for is a device that I can feed all the odd socks.
Yeah, the number of the goal, you know, that one.
Once you've got about a dozen or so, you feed them in, and out comes six perfectly matching pairs of socks.
I'd settle for an electronic device aimed at jamming personal stereos, something to keep Jehovah's Witnesses away, a machine which removes all other vehicles from the road when I have to drive somewhere, and something which could harness the potential energy of naval fluff. But in the meantime, duty calls.
Yeah!
The number to call, 353-8111, dialing from outside of town, start with 01.
And you can call on the topic of your choice. A couple of other things, as well as domestic appliances, we'll be talking about. I'll be having a chat with Sandy Forbes, our Nostalgia Street man, shortly. And he'll be talking about the old days when we used to go down the dance halls. Now, it was a bit before my time, but if you have memories of that, you could tell us about, then 353-8111. And also tourists, we have a report which suggests that the French are the people most hated by Britons abroad. 353-8111, more calls coming. If you're longing for
someone new, don't worry now. Why just keep longing for your ideal holiday when you can discover it in Dalton's Weekly? Turn to Dalton's Weekly and you'll find thousands of holidays all over Britain. Hotels, cottages, caravans, self-catering accommodation. Britain's biggest choice, up to the minute every week. So ask your newsagent for Dalton's Weekly and discover your dream in Dalton's.
Clive Bull.
And good morning to you. Let's check some of the main news stories this morning. And Irish Premier Charles Haughey says security cooperation between the Republic and Britain on Northern Ireland could be in jeopardy if there's not what he describes as fair play in the administration of justice in Ulster. Three police officers are in hospital after being beaten up at Manchester's Piccadilly Rail Station, where fans were returning from United's football match against Arsenal. And newspaper tycoon Robert Maxwell, we were hearing about this in our headlines quiz, appears to have chalked up a new media milestone. Today's Sunday Mirror, owned by the same Mr. Maxwell, begins serialising a book about his life, from his poverty-stricken childhood in Czechoslovakia to his present-day role as a press baron. And the weather in town, cloudy and dry. The minimum, 7 degrees in town, 5 degrees 41 out of town. And the day ahead, cloudy and dry again with sunny spells and mild. Top temperature, 12 degrees, 54 Fahrenheit. Beluga.
Exclusive fashion, style and ideas. Above all, ideas that work.
Beluga, Beluga.
Because at Beluga, we care about the way you look as much as you do. So come in and see for yourself what amazing clothes we've got.
Beluga, Beluga.
Beluga, fashion and style.
Beluga.
Beluga, 266 Uxbridge Road, Hatch End. That's 266 Uxbridge Road, Hatch End.
Well, I can honestly say the Latkes look delightful. I have fully crunched them up in the frying pan. Shlomo, I'm pleased with the look of the Latkes. What about the schnitzel?
Well, that should really have gone. Are they out of the frying pan?
They've just come out of the frying pan.
Right,
yes.
Put the schnitzel in quickly.
Quickly into the frying pan, yes.
It only takes a couple of minutes. Now, I want you to get your serving plate ready.
Yes, I've got the serving plate ready.
Right, now put the two fans of the cucumber, decorate them on the side of the plate.
Yes, I've got that.
And in the middle of the two of those, put a teaspoonful or so of the beetroot sauce.
Mm-hmm. Just open the beetroot. This is horseradish and beetroot sauce.
So there, if you haven't got that already made, it's very simple to make in advance.
Okay, we'll just slip a little bit of that onto the side.
James Ladbroke Grove.
And the schnitzel is bubbling away, so whilst that's cooking, it'll be a couple of minutes, won't it?
So keep the Latkes warm meanwhile.
I will, yes, they're on a warm heat. We'll have a word with James, who's next. Hello, James.
Hello.
Hello, good morning.
How's it going?
It's going pretty well here. Are you much of a cook?
No, really, no.
No, I know.
No, I'm trying my best.
Yes, me too. I'm struggling here, but I'm doing all right. What did you want to say?
It was just the innuendo about the British and the French.
Oh, yes.
And how you classed the British as the English. The Scottish and the French were hell of a pals for a lot of years.
Phyllis Thornton Heath.
Went to France.
So you're saying that it's only the English who are not keen on the French.
Exactly.
Do you think that's even true
anyway?
Especially
the south of England. Yeah.
Well, I suppose they are nearest to the French, aren't they?
Yeah, so it's easier to have wars, kind of a thing.
So the Scottish have always been friendly with the French, is that
what
you're
saying? Yeah, well, Bonnie Prince Charlie when the English threw it.
That's true.
he fled to France, didn't he?
Yep, yep.
So it's wrong to say the British kind of a thing. Do you know what I'm saying?
I do understand, yes.
Right, okay.
We'll make that distinct. Thank you very much.
Yeah. 353.
Bye-bye. 353-8111, if you'd like to join us on that.
Phyllis.
Let's have a word with Phyllis now. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello, Phyllis.
Hello there. Nice to speak to you.
Yes, and you.
Yeah. Well, it's regarding your comment. It so happens the second time I've heard it on the radio regarding the fact you'd like a device to keep the Jehovah's Witnesses from the door. Is there a reason? Was it just a joke or a bit of free advert for us?
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah.
But you think it'd be useful, do you?
Sir?
You think that'd be useful, do you?
Oh, no. Why do you want to keep us away? I mean, I'm speaking as one of Jehovah's Witnesses myself.
Well, I think that's just a...
Well, I know you've led me into here.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going to have to leave you, Phyllis. What's the matter, Peter?
I've been suggested that I should come and...
Oh, I see. Your nose led you in here, did it? Well, I'm just cooking up a schnitzel here. It seems to be doing rather well.
You guys will survive?
Yeah. I'm going to have to toss this over, though.
Oh, blind, I'm moving.
Yes, I would. I'd get back. I'd get back if I were you, because there's deep oil going there. Yes, look at that. That's fantastic. You don't want to overcook turkey, though, do you?
What is it, turkey?
Yes, turkey schnitzel and a couple of latkes over there as well.
It was suggested that I should come and see how
well,
you're going on.
I'm doing pretty well here, yes. Good. I hope Phyllis didn't take that personally about Jehovah's Witnesses. I think they were basically talking about the idea of keeping people away from the door who do pester you. That might be something you want to take up as well.
That's nothing to do with me.
Well, you're...
People coming away, keeping them away from that
You'd be
door.
Better than a household device, really, wouldn't you? Hello, they're all turning up now. They can smell the food.
Well, it's pervaded out of the security area.
Was it really? Yes. Yeah, In fact, who needs a domestic appliance when we could just have you at the door, Peter, keeping away anybody that's unwanted? I think that's just about done, don't you? It's crisping up at the edges there.
A little bit more.
Shlomo's up.
Shlomo, I think this is ready.
Right, well, if you want to just pierce it with a knife and make sure there's no pink juice coming out.
Pierce it with a knife and make sure there's...
Take it out of the oil.
What are you going to do with that one, Clive?
Well, I'm going to eat it, of course. Ow. Yes, I think that's well and truly done.
Right, put it on the plate with the latkes and the cucumber and the horseradish and beetroot sauce.
Well, I ain't done that. You reckon you'll manage to survive the program, is it?
Well, I don't know whether I'm going to have time to eat it all. I'll have to share it with the production team. Let's just dry it off a little. Oh, it smells gorgeous.
This is also a little of your...
That's the latkes, Peter, yes. That's the latkes, yes. Oh, the thyme. The thyme smells gorgeous.
Mm. How's it looking?
It's looking crispy golden brown.
Muddled off, Clive.
No, not 20.
That's
no,
latke,
no. Time the herb, Peter.
Sorry about
yes, try and concentrate if we can. Oh, that's fantastic.
Have you tasted it?
Clive, I wouldn't let you down by
Clive?
Yes, I'm just going to... Peter, have a look at that. What do you think of that?
You must eat it with a bit of latke all at the same time.
If it tastes as good as it smells, you should be all right.
Well, I know. It smells gorgeous, doesn't it? I'm going to try a little bit here.
Did you prepare that from the start?
Oh, yes, yes.
I mean,
yes.
You started with the basic materials and coated it. And
I've gone all the way with these, yes. Let's just try a little bit of latke, shall we, first of all?
Should try it all together.
All together, OK. I'll get a little sandwich together and we'll give it a go.
They sound good.
That's fantastic. Paula, tell me what you think of that. Just have a look at that.
It's amazing.
That's fantastic, isn't it?
The cucumber.
I know, a little fan there.
Oh, it's sweet.
And just smell that thyme.
It's not fresh though, is it?
It's not fresh, no. You can smell it really, can't you? Well, I'm going to nip down to the studio and have a quick bite of this. In the meantime, we'll hear from Sandy Forbes, our Nostalgia Street man, who regularly plays music from the days when a Saturday night out would mean a visit to the local dance hall. I'd like to hear your memories of that as well on 01353811. I asked Sandy what era he was talking about, and we're going to be hearing Sandy on that subject very shortly. Jonathan's come up here as well. What do you think? Just take a look at that.
Oh, it's very nice.
Oh, don't take it all.
I'm not.
It's been hours cooking this.
It's fantastic, isn't it? Have a piece of latke, Peter. Shlomo, they're very impressed.
I'm glad, Muzzle Dog, you could work at the restaurant now, guys.
Oh, it's terribly kind of you to give us all this advice.
I'll go down and wake up Sandy.
Okay, if you could wake up Sandy, Jonathan, yes, jolly good. That's fantastic. Schlomo, that's marvellous. It's so kind of you to give us all this advice.
And perhaps next week I'll give you a good recipe for lochshan pudding.
Yes. But we had a caller last night.
That's right, I heard.
Have you got any secret recipes for that?
I have, but not prepared. So maybe I'll wait till next week. We don't want to confuse people with too many recipes.
All right, then. Thanks very much.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Schlomo, for all your advice there. And they're queuing up, I can tell you, for a taste of the turkey schnitzel and the latkes. Now, back to Sandy Forbes, our man down Nostalgia Street. I asked Sandy what era he concentrates on.
1920s to 1950s. You might say the era of the 78 gramophone record. 78s appeared round about the turn of the century. But they didn't start to really take off in numbers of sales until the 1920s. But I really confine my activities to the 20s, to the round about the mid-50s, when 78s came off the market.
But the sound now is fairly crunchy, some of it, isn't it, to say the least?
Yes, I don't enjoy the best. We do our best about that. As a matter of fact, we have tried taking more of the background. We call it frying bacon, that sizzling noise. We've tried taking more background off, and I've actually had letters complaining, saying the thing doesn't sound authentic. But I would like to improve the quality of the records that I transmit. But I haven't yet been able to organise. It's rather an expensive outlay. There's American equipment one can... I'm working on it, let's put it that way. There's American equipment one can purchase to...
Yes. So was it that good quality in the first place then? Back in 1920, would it have sounded pretty good?
Not really. You see, in those days, people played records with steel needles, and you got this... I mean, this background... I mean, they were so thrilled to get... to be able to preserve music in this way. I don't think they worried much about background noise. It applies to me. If I'm enjoying a piece of music, the background doesn't worry me. But there are some collectors of 78s who will do their utmost to remove the background. Of course, you've got to be careful, Clive, not to take too much background of the background noise, the hissing and that away, because then you can also lose valuable parts of the...
Well, that's what I was wondering. In a way, it adds to it, doesn't it? Because it sort of sounds... like it's in the right period, like certain films are better for being in black and white.
Yes, agreed. Mind you, I have heard 78s processed, and if it's done properly, it's surprising the musical jewels that are hidden away in those early grooves. It's all there if you can dig it out. Instruments that perhaps you wouldn't readily hear played in the old-fashioned way are there. You know, musical virtuosity is hidden often.
And were they being bought in great numbers, say, back in the 20s? Were they being bought in the same way that young people buy pop records now?
Yes, relatively, yes. I used to have figures at my fingertips. I've got them somewhere of, you know, approximate annual sales of gramophone records. I can't spout them, you know, but yes. Mind you, they weren't that cheap. Ordinary people couldn't really afford gramophone records in the early days. Woolworths had a lot to do with the
did
spread
they really?
Of... Yes, they did. They always had gramophone records. To get them down to their maximum retail price of sixpence, they used to be of small dimensions. They once, at one time, even had 5.5-inch diameter. and then they worked their way up to 9-inch. They never, not until after the war, they never were able to sell a 10-inch record at sixpence. But they got up to a 9-inch, and those 9-inch, that last 9-inch series they ran, were called Crown. And believe me, they were about they're about the best pre-war record surface you can find. Excellent quality. I mean, all this... In those days, you went to Woolworths, you did buy quality. In spite of these low prices, you bought quality. There's no question.
Was it young people, or was it people of all ages in those days?
I would say people of all ages. You see, there weren't the alternatives for entertainment. And I don't think... There's another point here we must consider that... I don't think young people had money to spend in those days. There weren't the high-paying jobs. I think the young who went in for apprenticeships and they didn't earn money for, much money for years, did they? It wasn't like today's conditions, no. I mean, your older people were buying them too. They bought them to entertain themselves in the evenings. So they might not have even had radio sets, you see. No television, of course. Discount that completely.
but we think about dance music, particularly these days. It's like the modern clubs and discos, and it's mainly young people. Were there in the 20s and 30s and 40s a lot of dances going on?
Yes, dancing was very much more popular than it is now. Everybody danced.
What would happen everywhere? What sort of dances? Well, not like modern ones.
No, all organisations ran dances. I mean, in my day, 25 years ago, in my sort of early 20s and that...
In your heyday, Sandy.
Yes,